The next speaker will be Dr. Komnou, is that it?
Yes, thank you. Good morning, dear colleagues from me also. I am very happy and honored to participate in this meeting. My topic is about fetal heart failure. Heart failure in fetus has different pathophysiology and clinical picture. In fetal circulation, the ventricles pump in parallel, and oxygenated blood comes from the placenta to the right atrium through the ductus venosus that regulates the flow, passes through the foramen ovale to the left cavities. Also, blood from the right ventricle is conducted through the duct to the systemic circulation. In that way, the two ventricles pump in parallel, and there is no difference in pressure between the atria or the ventricles. In that way, cardiac output can be retained even if one ventricle fails. Furthermore, the fetal myocardium is very mature, has less sympathetic innervation, functions only in rates between 50 and 200, and utilizes only glucose as a source of energy. It can respond to Frank-Starling mechanism, but soon and rapidly, the atrial pressure rises, and as a result of this, we have increased systemic venous pressure, reduced lymphatic flow, hypoxia, and hypoproteinemia. And the end result of this process is high drops and fetal death. High drops is the accumulation of fluid in serous cavities, as we see here in the abdominal and pleural cavity. ECHO has given us the possibility to look into the failing heart. We can detect structural abnormalities, as we see here in a fetus that is going to be born in the next several weeks, in which myocardial dysfunction is due to aortic stenosis. We can also estimate heart size, the presence of pericardial effusion or valve regurgitation. Also, by ECHO and by all the methods we have available, we can estimate systolic and diastolic function.
Για να δείτε τις διαφάνειες
diastolic function,
σε πιο ψηλά, πιο μεγάλα, πρέπει να τσετε διπλό κλικ στο projector live now.
In severe heart failure. And it can be recognized by the monophasic feeling of the that we detect in AV valves, the tall retrograde AV waves in IVC, and the retrograde flow in ductus venosus or
Παρακαλώ
in very
πολύ το Προεδρείο, όταν παρουσιάζει τον επόμενο μιλητή, να αναφέρει και τον τίτλο, ο οποίος βρίσκεται στο πρόγραμμα.
Ευχαριστώ πολύ. In middle cerebral artery. If we find lower resistance in the brain than in the placenta, then we have an ominous sign for fetuses with growth restriction. Also, a high velocity may suggest fetal anemia. Cardiovascular profile score is composed by five elements from heart and big vessels. It was introduced as a predictor for fetal outcome in very different conditions with myocardial dysfunction. The score of 10 is the appropriate for a normal fetus, while under six, the score is indicative of poor prognosis. The great value of this index is that by applying it in serial studies, we can have a uniform way to estimate fetal status. As we shall see, there are many cardiac causes of heart failure, but also extracardiac pathology with alteration in fetal loading can lead to high drops. We rarely observe heart failure in congenital heart disease, and that is because, as we said, the ventricles can compensate each other. Among the most prone to develop heart failure are defects that cause volume loading, as we see here in this tricuspid dysplasia with a huge tricuspid insufficiency and right atrial dilatation. The constriction of the duct imposes a high afterload acutely in the right ventricle, and this causes right heart failure, tricuspid insufficiency, and fetal high drops. The same is true for foramen ovale restriction, but in this case, if this happens early in pregnancy, hypoplasia of the left heart may be anticipated. Absence of sinus venosus is a rare defect and causes unrestricted flow to the right heart. And as a result of that, high cardiac output failure. How we manage all these conditions? The purpose is to improve function and prolong pregnancy. And nowadays, this can be achieved by a fetal intervention, as is in the case of restriction of foramen ovale or valve stenosis. In some cases, however, early delivery and neonatal management is preferable, and that is when we plant immediate postnatal intervention, or we have abnormalities in fetal shunts, or also patients with Epstein anomaly and functional pulmonary atresia, as you see here, do better with postnatal treatment. Arrhythmias, as you heard from Dr. Laskari, both tachyarrhythmias and bradyarrhythmias can lead to heart failure. And as you heard, this is the field we had as fetal cardiologists, the major success, which fact that is not true for cardiomyopathies. Hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, as you see here by the hypertrophy of the intraventricular septum and the small cavity of the left ventricle, is usually secondary to to syndromes or diabetes mellitus. And the prognosis depends on the underlying cause. On the contrary, cardiomyopathy dilated, in which we have dilation of the fetal cardiac cavities, and thinning of the walls cause is usually unknown, and the prognosis is very poor, as it is in this rare condition that is called arterial calcification, idiopathic, and is presented by high drops, as you see here, and heavy calcification of the great arteries. You see here the mold of the rings, of the vascular rings, and the whole aorta. From the extracardiac pathology, anemia from any cause results in high cardiac output failure, as we can detect in AV valves at peripheral vessels. In this case, this fetus was detected with heart failure in a routine scan. And after that, fetal anemia was detected and blood transfusion by the fetal medicine specialist restored completely the heart function, and the baby is now 2 years old and completely healthy. Sacrococcygeal teratoma and other arteriovenous heart malformations act in the same way. In this fetus, that heart failure was diagnosed, and the sacrococcygeal teratoma, due to the sacrococcygeal teratoma, was given birth right after diagnosis and survived operation. But nowadays, we have the opportunity to have in our disposal interventions with occlusion of feeding vessels or fetal surgery that have a great mortality still, unfortunately. The recipient of a twin-to-twin transfusion develops hydrops due to a very complicated pathophysiological mechanism that involves increased afterload, right ventricular hypertrophy, and increased systemic venous pressure. Nowadays, besides drainage of the amniotic fluid, laser occlusion of the responsible vessels can prolong pregnancy and improve survival. Finally, another mechanism of heart failure is heart compression by thoracic pathology. As is congenital cystic adenomatoid malformation or diaphragmatic hernia. The compression of the heart leads to increased CVP and hydrops. Progression in fetal medicine made available interventions like thoracoamniotic shunt or occlusion of the trachea that can prolong pregnancy. In conclusion, I would like to say that the etiology of fetal heart failure is very diverse, but quite important for the successful management, which is to improve cardiovascular function and prolong pregnancy as long as possible. Close follow-up and multidisciplinary approach is of critical importance, but the most exciting of all is that in this way we treat fetus as a patient. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was an excellent presentation by Dr. Komnou. I don't see any questions from the chat.
I would like to make a comment, Panos. Yes, my congratulations to Dr. Komnou also. It was a pleasure to hear him saying about the invasive procedures that we are supposed to do, the fetal surgeons. Just to summarize that, if I understood well, so all the fetal surgery procedures, the indications for them is the presence of hydrops. So if there is a cardiac insufficiency, in all these cases, we don't do anything. But if the baby becomes hydropic or has any ductus venosus changes, then we are supposed to intervene. And the categories of the intervention are firstly the shunts that very nicely she said. Just in her picture, it was a cecum with many solid components. So we do the shunts only when the cecum has very big cystic components, We have done such shunts in Attikon, and these thoracoamniotic shunts have an excellent prognosis. We cannot say the same for the bladder shunts, but the thoracoamniotic shunts go very well. The other category she mentioned very nicely was the tumors that they act as shunts. I could add, she said the sacrococcygeal teratoma, which is very hard to manage in any way, but there are other tumors also, such as the cholangiomas, which are very characteristic in acting as a shunt, develop hydrops, and they can be managed more successfully by fetal surgery. Thank you very much again for your talk.
Thank you.